Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in. I'm Zach Peterson. I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're going to talk about a very important quantity in transmission line theory called the propagation constant. So what is the propagation constant? Well, it actually appears in some of the equations that we've shown in some previous videos on just basic transmission lines, and also in a video on differential pairs. So if you haven't had a chance, check out the links in the description and go review those videos, and come back here and you can learn all about the propagation constant. Let's go ahead and get started. We want to talk about something in transmission line theory called the propagation constant. If you remember from previous videos, generally what we're looking at with the transmission line is we have our line and we have some signal traveling on it. It's going this direction. And then we have some reference plane. I'll just write it out as REF, or generally GND for ground. And there is some capacitance between the line and ground, and the line itself has some self-inductance. It's a pretty poor inductor signal, but we'll go with it. And then it also has some DC resistance, and then it also has some what we call shunt conductance, which we use to model the dielectric losses for the electric field, or the electromagnetic field, that's traveling along this line through the substrate. This is my L, so my RLGC model. Within this model, we have a very nice compact equation for the characteristic impedance. It is just Z sub zero equals square root of R plus I omega L. So the omega is the angular frequency, and then G plus I omega C. And so if you look at a previous video on transmission lines and the characteristic impedance of transmission lines, I actually go a bit deeper into what all of these terms mean, and you can actually find some more specific formulas in that video that describe what the G term is and some of the effects that happen in real transmission lines and how these terms contribute to loss. So remember, this is a lossy term. This is also a lossy term. There's also a skin effect term that happens here, and that's a bit more advanced. If you look on my channel, you'll be able to see a number of presentation videos at conferences that go a bit deeper into this formula if you're interested. We'll also do some more videos on it so that you can learn a bit more the advanced aspects of characteristic impedance. Remember, this signal is traveling on this transmission line, and the signal does not travel instantaneously across the transmission line. It actually travels at the speed of light, we'll just call it V, in this medium. So this medium, wherever the medium that exists around the conductor, is going to determine what this velocity is. So how does this relate to the propagation constant? The propagation constant has a very simple relation, okay? So the propagation constant, gamma, is just equal to square root of, and you can always remember it like this. It's this numerator multiplied by this denominator. So it's just R plus I omega L, G plus I omega C. This term gamma is actually very important because this is actually a wave number. And so if you remember your wave mechanics, if you've ever taken any physics classes that deal with wave propagation, even if you've taken like an acoustics class, you'll hear this very important quantity called a wave number. So when you're dealing with just a single frequency or a single wavelength, usually what you would do is you would actually write this as K equals 2 pi divided by the wavelength. Now, what's important here is this. It's not so much that we have this. What's actually important here is that gamma divided by omega is equal to 1 over the velocity of this this signal that's traveling on the transmission line. If I can just factor out this omega term here and then divide it, and then we, you know, take a limit, let's say, as omega gets very large, you can actually derive a very familiar result. And so this term, this gamma, tells you essentially how fast the signal is moving along this this transmission line. So you can go back to, say, what is the speed of light? So V is equal to C divided by some effective dielectric constant. So if you're an electrical engineer, if you're working in the PCB space, you usually use dK to represent the dielectric constant. And The effective part just accounts for the fact that if this is a microstrip, decay might be 4 or 4.2, let's say, for like an isolo laminate. Decay might be 4.2 for the PCB substrate. But the real decay value that affects the signal propagation speed might not actually be 4.2. So it depends on the geometry of the conductor. It depends on where it's located in the substrate. So if it's an external trace, like it's on the surface layer, it's on the bottom layer, you actually have decay effective is approximately, and again, it's going to depend on, you know, geometry and everything, but it might be something like, you know, 3.3. There are calculator applications you can use to calculate this. If you know decay at this specific frequency that you're looking at, you can calculate decay effective at that same frequency just based on the geometry of your line. So here, I mentioned that if we factor out omega, we can get back to a velocity. So what happens if I factor out the omega from here and then I determine what the velocity is of this this trace that's traveling along, this signal that's traveling along this trace. So I'm going to factor this out and I get omega or gamma over omega equals square root r over omega plus I times L, and then g over omega plus I times C. If I just take limit as omega gets very large, what's going to happen? Well, I'm going to have r divided by infinity, so this goes to zero. I have my g term divided by omega, this goes to zero. And so in a perfect world where we don't have any problems with copper roughness or skin effect, I get back to 1 over my velocity is just square root of L over C. This is sometimes stated as the propagation constant. What they're really referring to is like a propagation delay, okay? So it's not exactly the same thing as this. So just be mindful of that if you ever see this stuff in textbooks or in guides online. This is usually expressed in units of like nanosecond per meter or picoseconds per inch, something like this. So this is 1 over a velocity, so it's expressed in time per distance, as you would expect with an inverse velocity measurement. So that's essentially what this means. This means that you can calculate the time required for a signal to travel along a trace with a known distance, and you can do that at any frequency you like, as long as you know the different parameters in here. And then that gives you the time that's required, and you know everything about the signal behavior. In reality, when people talk about this this function here, they're usually dealing with one specific angular frequency. So they're dealing with like just 100 megahertz or just 1 gigahertz. We brought this up before that a digital signal, as I've shown here, does not actually operate at just one frequency. And so this is what makes a digital signal a digital signal. It has its frequency content spread out from very low frequencies all the way out to, mathematically, all the way out to infinity. So this digital signal has some bandwidth that defines how the energy is distributed over the frequency domain, and some bandwidth that's relevant for us as the designer that we need to consider when we're actually designing traces and choosing components to work with different signals and recover them and everything else you need to do in a board. We'll do another video on digital signal bandwidth because it is an important concept in high-speed design. Since most designs are bordering at the edge of high speed anyways, I think it is an important concept for designers to know about, and it actually affects the propagation constant. So I'm gonna erase some of this and we'll look at exactly what happens at different frequencies with the propagation constant. What happens at different frequencies and what happens specifically in the propagation constant and how it affects signal behavior at different frequencies. So first we need to look at what these different terms in this equation actually mean. So this R right here is a DC resistance. So by definition, it doesn't really depend on frequency. Now here, this L, we like to normally think of L, the inductance, as just being a fixed value over the entire frequency range, but that's not actually correct because here on this conductor, when we have high frequency propagation, meaning when there's a high frequency wave propagating on this line, we have something that happens called the skin effect. And the skin effect creates some additional inductance here that is proportional to the square root of frequency. So what that means is that I omega L actually transforms into some I omega L sub zero, we'll just say the inductance is if there was no skin effect, plus some I times square root of frequency times some skin resistance. This adds in some additional inductance through this I term here on the right hand side of this transformation into the inductance in the transmission line. And so what that does is it creates some additional loss. This is one of the problems with high frequency propagation, is that you do have these additional losses that pop up, and the skin effect is one of them. Now, when you're dealing with a trace on a PCB, it's not just the skin effect. The skin effect actually gets enhanced, because here along this bottom surface, this trace is not perfectly smooth. It's actually rough. And that roughness essentially increases the additional impedance that's generated by the skin effect. And so that's normally factored in with a copper roughness factor K. This is a bit more of an advanced topic, but it's something that I like to have, you know, I do like to talk about because my own research is on it. And I think it's something that's important for designers to consider when they're selecting materials and when they're looking at any sort of cross-sectional images of the PCB, is to realize that this surface on the bottom, and if this is a strip line, it'll also be along the top, is going to be somewhat rough. There's an article that is in the description that's going to break this down and show what exactly it means and what causes this roughness. And again, you can go onto my channel, you can check out some of my presentations, I explain it as well. There's also some great articles out there by Bert Simonovich. He is really an expert in this area on copper roughness. I will put some of those in the comments. Your design software should be able to take this into account. Now, not all design software applications can do this. Altium Designer does have the ability to consider copper roughness in the layer stack. So when you're inside the layer stack manager and you're doing your impedance calculation, you can actually set a value for the copper roughness factor. Now remember, this is process dependent. So it's going to depend on what your manufacturer is able to do. They may not measure this. It may be something you have to infer from microscope images. So like I said, it's a bit more of an advanced topic. And if you're not operating at super high frequency or super high speed, probably don't need to worry about it. This is more for your information in case you ever do get up to that level in the future. Now, the next effect that we need to consider here in terms of how everything affects different frequencies is what happens with this G term and the C term. Now, remember, C is proportional to the real part of the dielectric constant. And G is proportional to the loss tangent. So if you look up the definition of loss tangent, you'll know that it is essentially the negative, and I use the negative sign intentionally. So if you remember my previous video, I don't know why electrical engineers keep emitting this negative sign, but this negative sign has to be here. It is proportional to the negative of the imaginary part of the dielectric constant divided by the real part. So the dielectric constant, both parts of it, appear inside this square root for the propagation constant. Now that's very important because this term is a function of angular frequency. This term is also a function of angular frequency. So they're both going to change at different frequencies. And so what that means is that different frequency components that make up your digital signal will propagate at different velocities along this interconnect. So you might have the high frequency component in your digital signal propagating a bit slower than your low frequency components. And so this is one of the things that contributes to distortion of this signal as it propagates along an interconnect. So you have losses that are different at different frequencies. So the higher frequency components tend to get lost more due to absorption in the dielectric. But the skin effect also contributes to that. So all of this stuff works together to give you some additional losses as a signal travels along the transmission line. And so the net result is that you don't actually have these sharp edges here. Essentially what happens is the signal kind of smooths out like this as it propagates along the trace. So, you know, what may have started out as a bit more sharp edges here, a bit more sharp edges here, back in this area of the board where you had your transmitter, what actually appears here on the output side of the trace looks a little bit more like this blue curve. That's essentially everything that goes into the propagation constant. And I know there's a lot of math here and a lot of physics, but the important point here to remember, and I think it's important for all designers to remember, is that this value, the propagation constant, and the associated velocity. Remember, the velocity is speed of light divided by square root of the dielectric constant. Dielectric constant changes with frequency. This can be different at different frequencies. That means different frequencies will have different propagation constants. So when you see a number quoted on someone's website that says, oh, the propagation constant is, you know, this specific value, whatever value they quote. I think, you know, they might quote like, I think six nanoseconds per meter or something like this. I don't have the value memorized. But the point is, when they quote that value to you, they're actually only talking about one frequency. So that doesn't mean that you're going to have that same value for a different frequency. Now, this will actually become important when we start talking about RF design, because in an RF design, you actually need to have a very precise value for this at your frequency that you're going to be working with. And that's very important when you're designing printed RF circuits, if you're designing transmission lines that are going to carry RF signals, when you're looking at input impedance for RF signals that are about to travel down a transmission line, if you're using stubs for termination. These are all different topics that we want to talk about in RF design. And so we'll get into that in a later video. This is a huge topic that's near and dear to my heart, especially coming from a background in optics and electromagnetics, and now I get to do it in PCB design. So I love talking about this stuff. If you like this video, hit that like button. If you want to see more of these videos, hit the subscribe button. Please feel free to leave your questions and comments in the comment section. We love to hear them. And don't forget to check out the links that are in the description. You can also go and get a 15-day free trial of Altium Designer in the description, and go click on that, go give the software a shot, see if it works for you. Thanks for watching, everybody, and don't forget to call your fabricator.